Hello, welcome to the second week of application programming interfaces. Last week, we learned about various API platforms and management tools, such as Postman. And we also discussed what an endpoint is used for, how developers parse and manage this data for their applications and programs. Today, we're going to cover some terminology and go through a few examples. One in particular is the curl command, which stands for client URL. This is a Linux command that will allows you to transfer data to and from a server. You can use any number of protocols, supported protocols, including HTTP, FTP, SFTP, TFTP, and so forth. The current endpoints that we're going to discuss are representational state transfer, meaning REST API. These are public access. They aren't particularly used for anything important, but they're useful for learning. To get started, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And I want to cover a few actions or methods. In particular, get, post, put, and delete. These are methods that can be used when performing API calls or calls to endpoints. Whenever you send requests, these are request methods. So get actually retrieves information from the server that you're sending the request to. Post will save data on that server. Put updates existing data, and deletes existing data. For example, you can actually use Twitter's API to post tweets using an authorization token or OAuth value that's provided with your account. You can head on over to Twitter's API documentation for more information on that. So I'm going to go ahead and open up Postman here in a minute. I just wanted to show you this one more image here. So here we have the database and web server that you're sending the REST API to, API call to, and this is your workstation or your computer, or also known as a client or node on a network. Here's a few common environments that you might encounter when working in IT roles. On-premises. So everything highlighted in blue here on this graph is what the employee or you will manage. And orange is what the other party that you're getting the service from, what they manage. So you have networking, storage, which would be like database servers, which hosts those databases, and virtualization, which hosts those operating systems. Middleware, runtime, data application. So on-premise is where you manage everything. Infrastructure as a service, IaaS, pretty much manages the network side of things. You may handle all the client side, and this handles the server side. Platform as a service is a common kind of, probably the most common of infrastructure environment or information infrastructure environments you might encounter, because typically businesses need to develop applications for their specific purposes. However, when you operating systems are very general use, you have Linux, which is extremely versatile, and then you know Windows, which is geared towards business, and Apple is geared more towards entertainment. So they fit a lot of needs. So you don't actually need to develop your own operating system, right? Why would you do that? That would be, or even manage and support it. You can pay Windows to Microsoft to manage and support your Windows operating system suite for you. And it comes with a lot of other packages. So again, I believe a lot of people are familiar with these, you know. And and we will actually see an example of this here in a few moments. What's our time here? Okay. So let's go ahead and get started on some API calls. I'm going to go ahead and open Postman. So here we're going to find, we're going to search for an existing public API collection that Postman provides. But Postman is an API application, or I'm sorry, it's an application, but it's a management tool for sending requests to different APIs. And it's really convenient. And for example, so let's go ahead and open up a collection and get an API address. And here they actually have a student program, which could be used in future courses. This is just an introduction. So we're not going to get that deep in the weeds yet. So as you see here, there's various examples. If you ever watch the show Game of Thrones, you want to find information about your favorite characters. Now, these I don't think are kept up to date. They're not like your fandom sites or wikis, but someone was nice enough to host this and share it with the world so people can learn how to send API requests. So really quick, I'm just going to grab an example. So if you're familiar with Studio Ghibli, they produce films, anime films out of Japan. And so what we have here, it automatically defaults to Git. So here you have this dropdown. This is where all your different API request methods you will find them. You can actually, perhaps, I'm not sure about this, but I think you can include these when you actually send an API request via your browser or even the command line. We'll get to that in a minute with the curl command that I mentioned earlier. So for now, we'll just leave it as Git because that's what the host here is expecting. So as you can see, we have our hypertext transfer protocol, HTTPS. This is the domain name. So here, this isn't a hosted on-premise. This is hosted through IaaS, or I'm sorry, PaaS, Platform as a Service, Heroku app, or Heroku. They're a software provider, and they host, if we refer back to that diagram from earlier. Platform as a Service handles all the operating system down to virtualization networking, and even some middleware, whereas you handle your data and your applications. That doesn't mean data, database can be hosted on a server by virtualization. So this is data that you collect and store yourself, right? So you would store it on their server, on their database, which you can have access to. And the easiest way to access that is with API calls. Instead of actually loading up some kind of SQL Server Management Studio, like SSMS, or a SQL Developer, which Oracle provides, their leading tech company, for enterprise computing applications. But so instead of you know, managing the database yourself, the database is managed by a team, by a provider, service provider, and you can send and receive information by queries and methods through API calls. That's why they're so useful. And the best part about it is it can be done programmatically so that the application, you can design an application to execute these requests and process this data programmatically. So the Roku app is an example, a real world example of platform as a service. That's what their company offers. So here they're hosting this Ghibli API. And here you can see our resources films. So we're just drilling down, think file folder management suite or file explorer or directories like that. So let's send the request. Okay, so really quick. So a lot of these APIs, since they're public, they have these REST APIs, they have fair use policies. So meaning there's a limit on how many requests you can send within a given period. So the same IP address can only send so many requests within a given period. Facebook graph or Instagram graph has like 50,000 or something like that, or 50,000 or 5,000. That's one example. And Postman is aware of this. So as you can see, requests can't be sent to public workspace right now. They're working on that for a future release. You can fork discussion into your workspace to send requests. So what we're going to do is use local resources. So instead of storing our cache on the server that we're sending requests to, we're going to store that cache locally by Postman. Think if you ever used GitHub, you can fork a repository or a package of code, programs. You can fork that onto your machine in an environment where you can modify and test and update different software programs that you manage and maintain or develop. And then you can push those requests up to the server where the actual program, where the applications are being hosted. In this case, GitHub is more of like a repository, represents just files, a package that goes with or associated with your software application. So in this case, this is a similar to that, analogous, we could say, creating a fork for this collection. So I already have an account. I'm just going to call this public REST APIs. And you're welcome to follow along. Postman is free. All the software that I'm using is, most of it is free. You could pay for an upgraded suite, but for all intents and purposes of this lecture, the free versions are sufficient. And we're not going to be using auth tokens. We can get into that in a later lecture or even in another course. I feel that today, just sending a request, this is something to celebrate. So here you can see the documentation. We were looking at the anime, which included the Studio Ghibli. So what I want you to do is if you do have this pulled up, you can actually follow along. So here, let's send the request. What you're gonna get back is this block of data. So all this information, what these are, key pair values. So you have an ID, and then an associated value with that. A title, associated value. Original title in Japanese or title in English. And then the description. So all this information can be retrieved. Right now, the formatting is in JSON. So these are JSON arrays. You can change it to XML and R auto. If I were to take this URL right here, right, and let's copy that into a browser tab. You should get the same block of information back. Not in all cases, but typically these REST requests can be done via the browser tab. But this information isn't necessarily useful in this format, so data scientists or data engineers can format the data and parse it in a way that's meaningful and store it in a way that's accessible. But this is an example of actually sending a GET request to retrieve data from the server. Really quick, I wanted to show you how Postman isn't necessarily required to send API requests, but it's useful, and here's why. So I know that we have people, locations, species, vehicles, films. So there's numerous films here, and you see these different URLs. Let's say we want to have a particular film. So there's one I have in mind that I liked a lot when I was a kid. It's Princess Mononoke. So I'm gonna just take a guess here. I'm gonna append the query to the end of our API call, our original API call. So right now, as you can see, as a typed here key in the key value, and check this box to include in the query parameters. These are called parameters. A question mark was appended to the end of the URL. And now it's filling in, Postman is, the values that I wish to follow. So these are query parameters that I'm gonna include in the API request and API. If it's expecting parameters, it will respond with different information. You can actually, this is how SQL injection tags are done on websites, because websites are typically using API calls to get their information. We're not gonna open that and access the database and server right from the web. It's a security measure, but it actually leaves a vulnerability, because you can, in the browser tab, unless you're using some sort of, I believe they're called masks. There are various providers that will allow you to create an alias for your website. And you can even have indexes included that will redirect users when they try to, move up to a different page on that they may not need access to. And so right here at the end of the URL, you can append parameters. And if you know the field names, table names of, because sometimes it will actually compile a SQL query, if you're familiar with structured query language, which is used in modern database systems and relational database systems. MySQL is another example. It will convert the parameters into a SQL query. If you know what tables you're looking for, you could access password tables, like user password tables. And what's done here is it's brute force. You constantly change and see how the website responds. It could give you a 404 error, but if there's changes in the page, then the page is listening, right? So not listening, but the server is listening for requests that include parameters, because these are optional in a lot of cases. So here we know this key value is title. We want to find that film that I remember so dearly from my childhood, Princess Mononoke. So I'm going to take a guess. I can tell the format here is uppercase. It's just like you would a title, lowercase in the capital sky. So Princess Mononoke, that's a name. It's probably going to be uppercase. And let's see if I can remember how to spell it. And as you see, my guess was correct. I actually got some data back. And it's only Princess Mononoke. If we go to our URL, it actually included title equals Princess Mononoke. So let's go back to our browser tab. Plug that in. So I could have just copy and pasted, but I just want to, I didn't delete my history or clear my cache, so it remembers. But yeah, you can do this title, right? So let's go ahead and type that in. And we get the same information back. And here, it's really nice to get your ID. You go down here to, so you can see here there's other URLs, right? And see how it has like species, that's our resource. And then it just has the ID appended. So the actual, I'm actually able to make another guess about the behavior or nature of this server, listener rather, it expects IDs after your resource. So why don't we take our Mononoke ID here and pop it in. This is just but this is HTML. So that percent sign 20 is just I believe it's hexadecimal for a space. But we don't need to get into that today. Let's just try this. And it took me back to the same page. So my guess was correct. That there's actually a URL dedicated to this API request, but you can also set it with the query parameter, question mark title equals Princess Mononoke. And I don't know all the IDs. I'm not gonna remember all the sequences. So let's try another film. Instead of Princess Mononoke, let's do another popular one. My neighbor Totoro. See if there's any Studio Ghibli fans in the room today. Looks like I did that last night as well. And there you go. My neighbor Totoro. So you don't actually need Postman, but as you can tell, Postman's convenient. because if I want to look at my information like this, you know, that's, I can do it, but it's a little difficult. This makes it a little more readable. And I can actually preview and visualize. And there's a lot of functionality here, because you can save each of these. Every time I go to a different collection, I open up a new tab. And I can change, modify these queries and have them saved and memorized. So this is why I wanted to show you Postman. I actually use this for my last job for a software company in the customer customer resource center, so like contact centers. And I manage API calls on their different scripts that they were using within another software provider called Massive Contact. They have a proprietary software service called that's used for managing contact centers. Anyways, this is a little history. So let's go ahead and get into the second part. So curl commands. So let's say we don't want to use Postman. We don't want to even use a browser tab. Let's want to use a terminal. So you can open a command, Windows command prompt even, and you can execute API requests via the command prompt using a command known as curl, C-U-R-L, which stands for client URL. And so let's just do a real quick curl dash dash help to see if we can get information. And as you see, in the standard output, we have a lot of information about curl. So curl has some options and then a URL. That's the format. This is the format or of usage of essentially this is a program. And if you've written programs in C, then this should look familiar. So an option that you can include as a parameter appended to the curl command that I'm really interested in is dash O. A dash O outputs to a file. So instead of outputting to a standard output, it outputs to a file. And the other one is going to be, I believe that's the only two that the only one that we're concerned with today. So let's take the same API call that that we got from Postman. There it is. And let's pop it into the command prompt. So I'm gonna open up Notepad++. This is another free tool that I use. You can actually write batch scripts to execute API requests and then store that information in a file. And here's an example of such batch scripts, which we can get into, but I just want to focus on sending API requests at this point. So I'm just going to open this up. And what's convenient, like I said, this already does what I'm trying to demonstrate. So I'm just going to copy this over and I'll explain. So I like to use the Notepad to edit because when I'm in the command prompt, it's kind of unforgiving. I paste it in here. See, as you can see, I'm already having trouble copying and pasting that. Like if I paste all this, I'm gonna get a bunch of nonsense that I'm not ready for. So actually another window's opening up. It's opening up another terminal because I actually have I was working on something. I was experimenting earlier. So let me go ahead and close that terminal. Anyway. It's probably close. So let's go ahead and edit that command. There you go. So we don't need it yet. So we have our curl dash O. Now this is the path for the output. This is actually on my computer's hard drive. C users. This is my name. Desktop. I have a output to Bitcoin that it's part of the program. This is something I'll demonstrate in a second. Let's just send it to the desktop. So we're gonna go ahead and rename this. And it's for its file type out, which is acceptable. You could change it to log or even a text file TXT if you wanted to. Let's do that. And we'll call this Jubilee out. I might not have spelled that correctly, but that's okay. So we have several parts here. You have a curl command, your initial command. And if we go back to our terminal, if I type in curl, it says curl, try dash dash out for more information. Let's see if I can zoom in a little bit. There you go. Okay, so then, you know, curl dash dash help was what we looked at earlier, and that's how we found out about the dash O option for outputting to a file. So let's go go a little further and that's this password there. Okay. Go a little further here. So curl dash O. And actually, let's just execute the API call first and then we'll output to a file. So we grab this API call. Studio Ghibli, same thing. If you're confused, I'll just go back to Postman. Same thing we grab from Postman. Same exact thing we put in the browser tab. Okay. So there I had the Mononoke appended. And I'm going to go ahead and use that version because I don't want to get all that data back from the command prompt or it might be confusing. So. It's going to be a hard time in copying. That's what's tricky about the command prompt. There you go. Okay, so what happened was is unlike the browser or Postman, when I send in title equals princess space Mononoke. It's actually searching for title equals princess. So there isn't any film called Princess. It needs to be exact. So what we'll do is we'll include quotes around the string value to remedy that problem. Processing. All right, it's taking a little too long. Let's see, it might not work because it might be expecting a different format. Okay, I'm gonna change my mind. Let's exclude the parameters. There you go. So we got all the films back. But I don't want to scroll up and down. I don't want to copy and paste from this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to append it to a file or output it to a file. So dash O, like earlier we had our path here. Okay, so we got some information here. I can't really tell you what it all means, but I can say that it seems self-evident. I don't know what expert is, but total requests, total received. So probably bits of information here. That's my best guess, right? It's probably a good one. but we can double check that. But again, we're not gonna cover that information today. We could do that another time. All right, so let's go to that location and see if that file shows up. So it's ghibli.txt, right? So let me go ahead and open up File Explorer. I'm gonna exclude the file name straight to the desktop. This is all my personal stuff. Behold, all right, here's the text file. And you can see here that the date created was 8/29/120 a.m. That's right now. And there's all our information. So if we actually wanted to parse this file or write a program that could extract this information, extrapolate it, we could do that, which I already have done conveniently. And I've included that program in the course, on the course website files. So you can download it and try it for yourself. And you can even make changes, which is something I kind of wanted to do, but I think we're not gonna go again, not that deep. We've already spent way too much time. Okay, so here's this program. I'm just gonna spare you the details for now. This is all C. If you wanna learn C, I'd be happy to provide some kind of extra credit. And even I would be happy to walk you right through it. So if you're eager to learn C, I think you deserve extra credit. Let's just put it that way. All right. So really quick, I'm going to switch terminals. So that was the Windows terminal. I'm going to actually switch. So we've demonstrated the curl command, how to output to a file, some options, what it means. Okay, great. So really quick, I want to show you something cool that I worked on over the weekend. This actually involves Bitcoin. And I'm not an investor in Bitcoin or anything like that. And I don't even know if this is going to be useful in any way. Like I'm not, I accept no liability for anything of that sort, investor-wise. I'm not an investor or a financial consultant. But this is a great way to demonstrate how we can we can use API requests to retrieve information, process and manipulate it. And earlier we talked about several different request methods. One of them was POST. POST will send data to be stored on the server or that you're sending the request to, or the API call to, right? Earlier, everything we've covered so far have been GET requests. So those GET requests, we covered them earlier, or we covered these different methods earlier. So POST would be something you use to send the information that you've processed back, or GET POST. So that's for new information. So say if you wanted to store a whole new instance, in this case, that's exactly what we're doing. And then the other, there was four of them that I went over, and PUT will update existing information. POST creates new instances, and DELETE removes them. And so let's run a Bitcoin command really quick. So let me go to Postman for the documentation. Cryptocurrency, CoinDesk, current Bitcoin price. So what this request does, this is a API endpoint hosted on by CoinDesk. It's V1, that's the resource we're pulling, BPI, current Bitcoin, current price, JSON. So this is gonna be in JSON format. So if I send this request, it's a GET request, I get this string of data. And you can see here, if you look closely, you'll see time, let's format it. So it's default to text, JSON. And that's what was returned back. So it makes sense to format it or present it this way, visualize it this way. So time updated. Down here, here's what we're interested in, rate. So there's that value in USD of the current Bitcoin price at 624 UTC. So that's Universal Standard Time. We could convert that to central, but if you want to do that, go right ahead. We're not going to do that. So, and then you have pounds and euros. And actually, you might actually need to do that for jobs. I've actually had to do that. I got schooled one time working with a guy, and we were converting time zones, and he was doing it all the top of his head. And then I realized that I had to start learning that. That's something I didn't really care about before, but yeah, it is because when you're working with businesses over different time zones, they might want to have hours where traffic is low, right? So, or should be low. So do not send these notifications, you know, past whatever. Text message in particular, my last job. So this is the API that I chose to focus on for my program, or my weekend project. And what my goal was to get the current rate as both a string and a float, and in the current time and the code, so meaning whether it's euros, pounds, or United States dollars, and store that in some kind of spreadsheet. So I chose TSV or tab separated value. You might be familiar with CSV, comma separated value files, is a file extension or format. The Excel, if you ever use Excel, it's familiar with. So every value is separated by a delimiter, in this case, a tab. And so my goal is, and then once I have the information stored there, I would use a a statistical computing language such as R or even Excel to perform arithmetic or just even visualization of that data. So let's get into that. So earlier you saw that we exited curl command, we can include options and different parameters. So my program, I actually wrote it in C. And the program, I have to use a different terminal called Cygwin, which is like a Linux command line editor or emulator. And so it has, you know, various libraries that you would expect to be in a Linux system included with all the different functions and methods. So this program, I wrote it in C, and what it does is it sends an API request via the command line, gets that information, parses it. So I've actually, this is only going to work for that API. This is not going to work for any other. Well, you can include other APIs, but it won't know what to do with the data. Now I do have the output of the data sent to a file. I use that dash O option that we looked at earlier. So you can actually send other requests and get the information back in that file. But when you open that file and read it in this program, it's going to not make sense because you're going to be assigning whatever is returned to, and it's only going to be looking for, you know, specific key values, which you saw earlier, like code. Let me go back to our request. Code. We're looking for code specifically and rate float. That's that float value I was talking about. So again, you can't execute other calls, but it's not going to be useful. So we're going to just execute that Bitcoin call or request. So really quick, let me just compile. I'm going to use GCC compiler, but just to make sure that the program will run. And here, to run the program, you just basically, I kind of cheated. I included the path to that value because I don't want to change directories and go looking all over the place. And then anything that's included after that is my program that I wrote expects an API call or just even a command that you would, like if you wanted to do, let me give you a quick example, like a PWD, right? It doesn't stand for password, it actually stands for present working directory. So that command, we just do a quick help, it prints the name of the current working directory. There are two options, L, print the value, if it names the current work directory, and print the physical directory without any symbolic links. So it behaves if this L was always specified. And you know, so if you sent that with my program, it would run. if you want me to, I can. Let me go ahead and get that command to run the program. If you've written a program in C, you might be familiar with the dot forward slash and then the name of your program, you know. In this case, like I said, it's assuming you are in the correct directory to where the program lives, where it exists. In this case, I am not. I'm in home C, so that's like even before the desktop. So I'm not even. It's not in the Bitcoin folder on my desktop. We're not there. So instead of changing that directory every time, I'm going to use the that shortcut, the path name. To the executable. And see, essentially everything after the path name, which has like C users desktop, current bcprice.exe, where my cursor is, everything after that is a command, is the curl command that we execute, or dash O. It's gonna pass it to GitHub API out, HVS CoinDesk, that's the Bitcoin API that we just called earlier at the Postman. And here I have some output. So the program ran successfully because if you look here, you see, hello world, this is the results command. I wrote that. And then the command that was executed, curl dash O, the result, and the actual information, the command result. And then here's some so this program is actually uploading that CSV file I was talking about when it's run. So if I go and open that CSV, see, if you look here, read closely, it says this file has been modified by another program. Do you want to reload it? That program is the program that I wrote. I just want to emphasize that. and so this is the tab. So each of these values is separated by 10. You can open this up in an Excel spreadsheet. I don't have Excel. I didn't pay for it. So we could open it on the browser and I can do all that. But instead, let's just open up another programming language called R. I thought it'd be cool to introduce you to something that, you know, data scientists might actually do. So this information took me a long time to parse, to figure out how to parse. And again, it's not, I don't think this is going to be like used or applied, but it's a great example. So when I open up R, I actually have a workspace prepared. And, you know, earlier I talked about posts. So after we manipulate the information, we want to send it back. We're not going to do that because I don't have any, I didn't look for a public API that actually, and then study enough to say, okay, I want to post this information. I just figured, you know, getting information and then manipulating it and knowing that we can post, you know, we could get into post another time. We might even get into creating our own endpoints at some point. But again, we'd have to host it on some server, like, and maybe get a free trial for Heroku app, for platform as a service, or even just host it like temporarily on our machine. What's really cool is, let me just dial back a little bit. Sorry to be jumping around here, but going back to that TSV file, if you look, we have 95 lines, right? We have line 95, so that's actually just blank. If I run the program again, it's going to add lines to this. And it won't be the same value. So as you can see here, USD is $48,489 at you know, 6:31 today, which is, you know, Universal Standard Time. It's actually 1:20 in the morning. So 48,429. Earlier it was 48,449. Okay, it's been reloaded. So it's been 3 minutes. 3 minutes. So at 6:34 was when we just ran this program. And as you can see, it added. So we were at, I think we were at 94 lines, now we're at 97. So it appended new lines to the file. So you can set this up to where you're running a job or a service and your program can be sending this request every hour, every half an hour. And this file can keep growing over time. And so what you would have is, you know, all of the Bitcoin values at different intervals over a week. And you can say, okay, on average, the Bitcoin value goes up or down this much. You know, you can, I'm not a data scientist or a data analyst, but you can look for patterns in machine learning algorithms and artificial intelligence. That's what it's used for. There's a really great video on YouTube that I'm gonna suggest to everybody to watch after class or another time. It's only an 8-minute video. And it kind of demonstrates how to use an API from all the way from getting GPS coordinates from Google Maps, then taking that information and passing it into Instagram's API, and then retrieving all of the JPEG files for that specific that have been posted by users of Instagram publicly from that geo-coordinate location, or that have those geo-coordinates associated with the instance of the JPEG file. And the JPEG file is an image. So every image in Chicago, and you don't even have to log into Instagram. Well, it used to be you didn't have to log in Instagram. Now you have to log it. You have to use the OAuth token, which I described earlier. You actually use an authentifier or authenticator or a certificate and authenticate that you're a user. But even so, imagine, you know, you're on Instagram. You have to go to these pictures and you want all the pictures of Chicago. You ain't going to do that by hand. But the API requests allow programmers or application developers to programmatically query these servers and get this information without humans actually needing to do the work. The program, the machine does it for you. And then algorithms can be written to look at that information and to look for and specifically patterns of perform analysis. So I just wanted to kind of just do a little side note on how powerful these tools are in the real world. So like, you know, businesses might be interested in how many users are posting images at the world, at the fair or at this event at this given time. And, you know, that's how advertisements are determined to be sent to specific consumers. Hence, so far, I mean, the applications are tremendous, to say the least. So yeah, that video, I'll share the link on the course document. I can actually probably pop it in the chat here, but highly recommend you watch it. It's really quick and brief. None of the things that actually demonstrates work anymore, but because you have to use the OAuth tokens, but you still learn a lot, has a lot of value. And you'll be shocked. You will be shocked. I was shocked. So going back to R, again, R is statistical programming language. I already have Workspace. I'm not going to really teach you how to do this or explain. And I think that to understand, you may not need to. If you have questions, I'd be happy to answer them. But I don't think that you have to be an expert in R to understand what's happening or what we're doing with this information. So here's my Workspace. So actually I have to, so there's different ways you can manipulate data. So I'm going to go ahead and retrieve that data file. That file, current Bitcoin's rate TSV. This is a command to store it at what's called a data frame. It's in our context. And we can view that data set right now. So here is the same thing that you saw in that notepad document I had open, all that information, but it's in a nice cell format. And all 96 lines are here. And let me just show you how, like, what's really nice is that program will be updated every time that this program runs. It's going to add 3 lines of data to this TSV. It's going to change it. And so, in order to retrieve it, I actually have to run this data frame command one more time, and then view, and you're going to see that I've just added up to 108. So before we were at 90, this is the first time I ran that command for view data set, and it was 96, now it's 108. So we've added a few more lines. And if the program was running on a service, it would be constant. Okay, so now let's summarize the data. So there's a data summary. So what we have is code. It's character class, R recognizes that. 108 instances of code, which means just this is a header or a column, and this is your row. So there's 108, right? And we know that because we can see that at the bottom count, 108. Again, same thing for all these. So what's really nice about it actually, so here's some numerical data. And it calculated the minimum, in the medium, and the mean, and the max for us. And it's presenting it not as clean. You know, I would like to have the 2 decimal points after. But again, I'm not a data scientist. You know, I parse the data. It's just a weekend project. That'll be fun. So, but you can see here in the actual view, we have our decimal points included. And this is just a character string. I wanted to put the comma in there. I thought it'd be cute. Okay, so let's run a couple more commands. I want to show you some cool things. So I'm just going to do a quick mean on the flow rate, or the rate flow. So that's at 41,831. So that should be correct. I don't actually know, but really quick, I'm going to go ahead and attach the data set. I'm going to install a package really quick. It's not necessarily required. I want to. It is required for. What I'm going to attempt to do is query this data set and filter it so that we only get the US dollar amounts instead of the euros, pounds, and US dollars. And I'm using R to do that. Think of if you were to pull this TSV up in an Excel application spreadsheet, you could drill down and filter by code equal to USD. All right, so our package has been loaded. Let's go ahead and open up the library. This is called Deep Layer, or this people call it Deep Layer, but it's short for Deep Layer, which is a package. It's a, I believe it's a set of rules that data scientists and analysts have agreed to follow for formatting data. Deep Layer is a part of that. It's a package to come out of that community. Okay, so let's run some queries. Now that we have Deep Layer running, so it actually recognizes these different, the syntax I'm using. So we're gonna select code, rate, float, and time. We don't need the additional, this is just duplicate values here. So we're gonna go ahead and select those. All right, there you go. So you can see we got all 108. And we don't have to worry about, we just got three values here, code, float, and time. This is like a SQL query. Like if you were to select on a table called Bitcoin values now or something. And then, so let's go ahead and filter it. This is a real database management system. If you want to take that course, if you're interested in, you're more than welcome to. And I can answer any questions after class. Or at the end of the lecture. All right, so let's go ahead and sort by USD. Here it is, right? That's the one. Okay, so I'm gonna run this query, filter, and so all right, so there's the mean. Okay, I wanna just get the USD system. So there you go. So now instead of returning all 108, it returned 36. And these are the USD values. And as you might imagine, let's say we want to get the bit rate or the Bitcoin value in US dollars at a certain time period, right? So here I already have a nice little query set up that looks for from yesterday. 1300 hours and then yesterday at 1400. So great. So in between this hour, why don't we change that? Let's change it to yesterday at 1500 hours to today at 0500. Let's go 0600. All right. So if I run this, you should see the data set change here. It won't be 36, it'll have, as you can tell, this is already in order. And it's gonna have all the values from here to, you know, right here. That's what I expect to be returned. And sure enough, here's our 1502 and 531 today. So that pretty much concludes the entire presentation. There are so many things I could have gone into a little more, but I think we've covered plenty of material. So there will be a Q&A following the meeting, and I'll be happy to leave this up. But that concludes the recording session for the lecture. And so I'm going to go ahead and stop that now. Thank you very much for your patience and attending the meeting. It was a lot of fun preparing this and absolutely enjoyed getting into REST APIs. So.